Welcome to this conversation hosted by Emerald Technology Ventures. In this episode, we're going to explore the circularization of packaging and labels. Joining me today to discuss this topic is Shruti George, one of the sustainability and innovation leaders at Avery Dennison. So let's dive right in. Avery Dennison began in 1935 with Mr. Avery, who thought, what a great idea, we need a self-adhesive label. You've come a long way since 1935, and circularization is a major theme. You could argue that circularization as a theme was born in 1996. There was a paper written on the topic, and everyone thought, oh, this seems like a good idea. And the idea started to grow in the same way that a sneeze kind of starts to grow, and it's sort of tickling your nose, and it gets worse and worse and worse until finally, at some point, the sneeze erupts. At some point, Avery Dennison went through that paradigm shift from just being a label producer to being a global leader in circularization. What was the sneeze?
So, Neil, I like of us being defined as a sticky player, right? Because we did start in 1935. But we've always been defined by our spirit of innovation. We were always ahead of the curve. So part of this for us was also to look at what was happening in the industry. And the sneeze in this case was legislation. And I think there were two specific instances. The first one was China banning import of plastic waste into the country. And the second one, which is still happening across the board, is single-use plastics and what governments are doing with that, right? So I would call that the sneezing moment, and this is absolutely part of our, you know, strategic imperative, really looking at circularity and how do we kind of invest in it and really drive this change for our value chain.
But how you react to it is the critical thing, right? I mean, on the one hand, you have all of this imperative that comes down from on high, thou shalt not export waste to China, thou shalt not use single waste plastics. But somehow, you know, you have to put this innovative engine that's behind you at Avery Dennison to work. And not only do you have to put all of this innovation to work based on the strengths of the company that you have, but also you have to react to the requirements around the world, right? I mean, we talk about certainly the China impact on everybody around the world was huge. But how the Chinese react to labels and packaging is different than how the Japanese react to labels and packaging, and is different than how Europeans react to labels and packaging. And you guys have $5 billion of top-line revenue selling labels around the world. So you are particularly informed about these differences. How do you put your innovation team to work solving different problems all around the world like that?
So in general, our company is quite regional. So we really work with our regional teams on this. The mantra that we talk about is always global coordination, regional execution. It always happens in the regions, right? So, and I like the example that you bring about China versus Japan. So we've really embraced eco-design as a concept for our products. And part of that is actually talking about infrastructure and how nations react to what the infrastructure is in. I grew up in India, where we do not have a formalized recycling system, but recycling happened. Like, we would have what we call kabadi wallahs. So a person that would come home, pick up the waste paper. So we would have stacked like months worth of newspapers and magazines, and they would pick it up and go, almost for like 5 rupees or whatever. So it was almost a pittance for us. But they were making money off of it, and which I found very powerful as a concept, because this was not happening in the 90s, it was even happening in the 80s, right? That is an informal recycling system that works. The Japanese actually know how to recycle plastic, right? So they will take a bottle, take the shrink sleeve off, drop the bottle somewhere, the cap somewhere, and the label somewhere else, right? We need to kind of know how to design for those ecosystems, and we need to kind of drive that from the regions. And that's essentially what the company is really doing and doing well, in my opinion.
So if I understand that correctly, in some markets, you can depend on a highly educated, very informed, extremely compliant customer base who will follow instructions and do proper separation of all the various waste streams. And in those cases, you have perhaps more design freedom about the various ways in which you can put together a package and a label.
Which is what you see in Japan, by the way. They have the best labels in the world, I would say, but yes.
And in environments where you have a less compliant and perhaps
slightly... You have to design to it.
You have to design to it so that you're no longer working to the legislation, but you're just making it impossible for it not to be circular.
Correct. And in places where we feel like we can actually make a substantial dent in the infrastructure, we are actually investing in infrastructure changes as well. So I think we invested in a company called Roadrunner Recycling earlier in the year, and we kind of walking the talk, so to speak, right? So really recycling our own internal products, going to our customers, picking up the products, and then bringing it back to recycling. And these are pilots that we're running. We are very excited about actually making a change in how we see circularity for our own business. And that's important for us.
Do you see major differences between Europe and North America?
Well, in maturity of the legislation and infrastructure, obviously. Mm-hmm. Consumer behavior and demand in the US is actually pretty strong, right? And that's kind of driving the US system much more effectively than anywhere else. And I would say legislation is slow, but not much slower, because if you see what California is doing in terms of regulation, it's quite close to what Europe is doing. And we think that the US will also, the whole country will also not be far behind that.
So, you know, I would argue that packaging has three major purposes. It should contain whatever it's supposed to contain.
Yeah.
It should protect whatever it's supposed to protect, and it should inform the customer what's inside. So those are the requirements. But it's a missed opportunity if that's the only thing it does. So what about the data piece? What about the digitalization piece? And can we draw any conclusions about how Americans are adopting the digitalization piece of circularization against how Europeans are adopting the circularization and digitalization nexus, and Asians?
I think Asians are much ahead of the curve, right? We've seen this time and time again.
This is the vanguard.
China. Yeah. Where, you know, QR codes are a fact of life.
Okay.
Europe just started adopting QR codes much more effectively once COVID hit. But that's just a slice of the question you've asked. The way we think about labels is, because I'm going to pick the third one, which is the communication aspect, right? The way we think about labels is there's a brand identification. So the brand shows what it is for. There is absolutely an information, you know, what is the calorific content, what's the expiry date, all of that is important, and it's on the label. The third one, the one that we're really focusing on right now, is around the sustainability aspect. How do you track and trace? How do you make sure that the end of life is happening effectively? And this is something that we're driving through our value chain. We're really investing in bringing the physical side of our business and the physical side of what we're talking about in terms of labels with the data that we have, because we are everywhere, we are ubiquitous. And this is part of that, you know, enablement of our physical label that the company is really driving. We're really excited about that for the future. And that's part of our circularity journey as well.
And so, you know, if we look ahead, so let's say 10 years, let's look ahead to 2030. Hmm. What does digital and labels and circular look like for Avery Dennison? What's the missing innovation that we're going to plug in to solve big problems to make 2030 look different for you?
I will, before I go to 2030, I'll take a step back 10 years, right?
Sure.
If 10 years ago we were to look out and say, let's talk about solar and electric cars.
Okay.
There were quite a glimmer in most people's eyes, because the efficiencies you were talking about solar were so much lower than what we achieved not less than 4 years later, right? And that was actually something that you saw the whole industry coalesce around, and the supply really kind of created the demand almost in a way. And then you see the same thing with electric cars, where it happened faster than what you think. The one thing I will say about us 10 years down the line is I think the change will happen faster than what you and I can talk about. I think part of what is missing is kind of the integration of the back end, right? And It's both in terms of systems and the data part of it. So who is, you know, the trusted person to kind of hold the data? This is an important question everyone is grappling with, but I'm hopeful that it'll happen faster than we think it will.
So I don't want to overuse the analogy, but it sounds like you're saying we're right in the middle of an enormous sneeze.
Probably. No, you have given that analogy
I'm so sorry. Shruti, I have to thank you so much for sharing your perspective from Avery Dennison on the circularization of packaging and labels. Thank you so very much.
You're welcome. It was a pleasure.